Hi, I'm Graham Steele, Head of Product in Cyber here at SandboxAQ, and today I'm with Ryan Hurst, who is, I think it's fair to say, a world authority on key management. We can say that, right?
Yeah.
So how does the way that we use cryptography affect the right way to do key management?
It's a good question. I'd start with what's changed. We've not really changed the way we approach key management, but we are now adopting cryptography in nearly every system that we deal with. We're still using the same tools and the same playbooks. And that just doesn't scale to the problem that we're dealing with today. So I would say that understanding the way applications are using cryptography and which systems they're interoperating with becomes even more important than it's ever been before, because it's no longer as simple as changing a key. We have real-time systems that can never go down, that are distributed, and we oftentimes don't control all the components that they're interacting with, and they have really complicated software supply chains backing them now. So it's a much more difficult problem to tackle today.
Right. And yeah, this gets back to something we've been talking in this video series a bit about before, about observability, right? About that, where in other fields we have this observability, but we don't really have that in cryptography right now. Is that fair?
Yeah, that's fair. I mean, most organizations couldn't tell you where their what systems have cryptographic keys, when the last time they were rolled, how they're protected, how business critical they are, which applications use them. And that's a symptom of an unmanaged set of assets.
Right.
These are the basics that we would get right in other systems.
Interesting. So we talked about some of the things that had changed in cryptography that we haven't really come up to date with in our key management. The fact that it's everywhere, it's in these real-time systems, there are these complex dependencies, I don't know where it is. But there's another change in cryptography coming onto the horizon right now, which is the need to migrate to cryptography that will resist a large-scale quantum computer, right? So the so-called post-quantum cryptography, as we call it. How is that going to change key management, and if so, how?
I think it's going to change it in a couple of substantial ways. One is, for the last 20 or so years, we've been using the same cryptographic algorithms for basically all systems. But these new cryptographic algorithms have different properties. Some have really big keys and small signatures. Some are optimized for small computers, while others are optimized for large computers. I think what we're going to end up with is having a much larger set of cryptographic algorithms that we're going to have to contend with in systems moving forward. Beyond that, I also think we know a lot less about these algorithms. Uh-huh. So being cryptographically agile, something we've talked about for a long time and never really achieved, becomes even more important. There was a case of one of the NIST candidates getting announced, and then a few days later, it being broken. And we're likely to see this sort of pattern continue for a while until we get enough confidence in these new schemes. So agility becomes even more important than it ever was before. The other component would be scalability. Mm-hmm. We can no longer assume that cryptography is going to have a nominal impact on the overhead of the systems that we deploy. We have to go back to the world of the 90s, where we were concerned about every CPU cycle and every bit of memory again. Mm-hmm. So having observability into the impact cryptography has on systems becomes that much more important.
Right. Interesting. So that actually feeds back into the need for observability that we were talking about before. So we're getting this extra complexity that's going to add extra complexity to key management. So as we try and figure out how we go forward, it's always interesting, to consider what we got wrong in the past, right? So how can we learn from the ways that key management has failed in the past in ways that can help us go forward into this more complicated world and a little bit better informed?
Yeah, I think there's a long list. I don't know if we have time to cover them all, but there's a lot of lessons that we can take from what we've done in the past. One is, I think as an industry, we sort of started with the all or nothing philosophy to key management. In the very beginning, we were trying to put HSMs on every server so we could do TLS using keys protected in an HSM. Mm-hmm. That became impractical, not that it was ever truly practical. And so we left the rest of the cryptographic keys kind of out on their own, sitting in a file system in the clear. And we had a problem we called cryptographic sprawl, which we solved with a database where we copied all of the keys into And then we distributed them to everybody there. This led to a number of different problems that we have today. Recently, there was a vulnerability related to DKIM, where a vulnerability from 2008 came up, Debian weak keys. People are able to spoof these DKIM signatures to be able to pretend to be anybody else as a result of using these predictable keys. And this is a symptom of not having good key management practices, where how are we generating our keys? How is it that these systems had software libraries from 2008 and are still being used in 2024?
Right. Again, it's that observability issue, right? So it's like we knew about that bug in 2008. This was this thing where the random number generator in Debian was only generating like 32 different numbers or something like that. But what we didn't have was the observability to know that we were still using those keys.
And apparently we still don't know which libraries we're using because we're seeing these things happen today. So we can learn a lot from these historic events. Another one that we just had the 10-year anniversary of Heartbleed. Heartbleed involved a poorly coded piece of software loading a cryptographic key into memory, and an attacker could basically just knock on the front door of the web server and ask for a copy of the private key, and the web server would gleefully give it up. There's sort of two problems here. The first being that there was a security defect in software, but to err is human. Forgive divine, we have to expect that that's going to happen. And the other is we copied a very valuable key and we put it on the internet, right on the front of the internet. And these are things that we can fix the way we manage keys and at the same time become more agile so that we're better prepared to respond to having to replace every key in 24 hours because the whole world is exposed to this big key theft.
Right, right. So we can try and fix that pattern that led to Heartbleed. But at the same time, you know, the next Heartbleed might be kind of different, right? So we need to be ready and have that agility to be able to react. Okay, awesome, super interesting. So this is a really interesting time in key management generally. So if you want to find out a bit more about how we're looking at key management here at SandboxAQ and what we call unified cryptography management, we're going to have a couple of links under the video for that. Otherwise, don't forget to subscribe so you don't miss another video here on the SandboxAQ channel. And I'm just going to say, thanks very much, Ryan.
It's a pleasure.